Well, thank you very much everyone for coming along. This is probably the first gathering of Kennedy chiefs and other parts of the clan for hundreds of years of this nature. So it's really good to see everybody here. We have here, of course, Chief Brodie, appointed last year as first chief for 400 years. We also have here various other dignitaries. We have a couple of Shanakis. Joe right here, Shanaki from Kilkenny. We have myself. I was expecting one or two more. We've got a budding Shanaki as well, and Tom over here. We have what I believe is a direct descendant of the last great O'Kennedy Don, which is John of Polynorman. I believe he's descended from Connor of Bally Cahill, the last great O'Kennedy Don. We have, of course, our chief who's descended from the chart there, chiefs on both sides, from Norman and Upper Norman, from Daniel of Balmontotti and Rory of Balmontock. And I think that can stand up to a bit of scrutiny. We've got some farmers here. The Kennedys have been farming in North Tipperary for 1,000 years, and Pat and Matt are still at it. Matt might be a Ryan, but he's Kennedy a couple of generations back, and so he's well and truly authorised to be sitting in this group. And we have our Browns, of course, wise men who can make sure we don't run foul of the law by any means. And our ladies are always very welcome. I did expect some more because I want to be inclusive, however well we need that on. The purpose of this group is to talk about the recommendations I'm making in this book. The book has been exhaustive in its looking at Kennedy history in the barony of Upper Ormond. We've been here 1,000 years. There's no doubt that I came across Killaloo, across to Rathoulis at some time around the year 1000. And they came across because Malachy, the King of Iron, came down looking for this upstart Brian Boru to sort him out once and for all. There was a battle, supposedly the Battle of Nina in 994. Nina wasn't there then. I'm sure it was the Battle of Rathoulis. And at that battle, Donald McLaughlin, the chief at that time, was killed. Donald McLaughlin was the brother of Kennedy, the father of Brian Boru. After Donald McLaughlin was killed, I'm sure they sent across to Killaloo for reinforcements. The Kennedys, who were called Kennedys then, but they were Brian Boru's nephews and all those associated people, went across to Rathoulis to give them a hand. The history books tell us that they obtained the land without opposition. They obtained the land without opposition because they were invited in, because the people over there had suffered so many casualties. Once they got there, they spread out from Rathoulis out to Annamalee and Latterer and Dollar and Kilmore and all over Upper Ormond from there. They were there well before the Normans came, and there are records in the annals of the Four Masters of the Kennedys being there before the Normans. The Normans came along around 1170, a wall of iron came at them. So what did the Kennedys do? They didn't stand in front of them, they stepped aside and let them go through, and then picked them off one by one from behind. And the butlers thought that they had better do something to protect themselves, so they built a big castle at Mena. That was why they built that, and they built other castles at Latterer and Gisbunny and other places, so that they would have a chain of communication. There'd been no email or internet or postal service in those days. The only way they could get messages in and out was by a fast horse, because all in between there were the local inhabitants who would be waiting for them. So the Butlers did not ever subdue the Kennedys. They tried very hard on many occasions. In the end, they had developed treaties with them. They signed, the first treaty they signed was 1336 for giving the Kennedys 1,500 acres of land, which was already theirs anyway, and they consequently signed many treaties with them over the years. The Kennedys, of course, seeing the Butler build a big castle, thought, now that's a good idea, we'll build some castle, which they then did, and they had them all over Upper Ormond. That proceeded until the 1600s. By 1640, there were 72 Kennedy landholders who owned about over 14,000 statute acres of land around the world. Then along came Cromwell with a large army, and the Kennedys couldn't stand up to the Cromwellian army. So the landowners were told to go hell with a quarrel, and some of them decided they'd come down here into the mountains. And that's where we get people like Brady and others who some stayed on their ancient lands as tenants of the new owners, and importantly, the town's original farmers, and they've always been farmers, they have been for 1,000 years, and we can show that they have outlasted everybody. They've outlasted the Normans, that's why we're going to outlast that too. They outlasted the penal laws, they outlasted several hundred years of oppression. The Kennedys are still here, and that's attested to by 1,000 Kennedy baptisms in Upper Ormond in the 1800s. So there are many of them. Now, what can we do about that? The long-held Irish dream of getting their land back. Would you like to tell us about that, Lawrence? What's the chances?
Well, I suppose theoretically it could be correct, but practically it's a non-starter. Because imagine you said, well, we want our lands back. The present people are going to object. There's going to be demonstrations, petitions, protests at the door. You name it, we'll have it. And then who's going to finance it? You know, barristers are very expensive.
One way.
But that's it. Synopsis of it. I mean, Cromwell, as we say, the act was invalid because it didn't receive royal approval, the king having been beheaded. But then an act was passed in Parliament ratifying what Cromwell did. That's from the should we say the English point of view, then from the Irish point of view, you get to look what was the Irish governing the situation then. Was it the English or was it the Breton law? So, what do you
mean? Okay, so any chance of getting land back would take another 200 or 300 years.
Just make an observation. I think it's no harm to set it down the situation.
Exactly.
I mean, Hitler, for example, was supported by the German people. Trickery and everything else, nonsense too. So, that habit, politicians and people like that, have that habit of doing things. I think you set out your case, your preamble, if you like, and then you say that we're reasonable, constitutional people.
Yeah.
An idea to commemorate the importance of the Kennedys.
Okay, so thanks.
The Jews were. What they were recovering was miracles, highly pictured. It's easy to recover a picture or jewellery or gold.
But 14,000 acres is a bit hard.
Get hold of 14,000 acres.
So the proposal is this. The facts of history, according to Dermot Gleeson, the Kennedys and their seals would have a claim founded on the facts of history, which is outstanding and indefeasible. There are some injustices too great to go unredressed. Okay, so how do we get this injustice redressed? We can go through Irish law and take 200 years to do it and get everyone upset in the process. Well, we can go to international law. And in international law, we can find the opportunity to go for commemoration and memorialisation, which is available through international law. Commemorate the fact that the Kennedys have been here for 1,000 years and memorialise them. There are plenty of memorials all over Ireland to various things. My suggestion is that we set up a group. We've got a chief, we've got an annual gathering, we've got a newsletter, but we don't have an organisation, a formal organisation. I think we should set up a formal organisation under the auspices of the Tipperary Heritage Plan 2013-18, which allows for promoting awareness, knowledge and appreciation of heritage, and to encourage participation in heritage events and activities in the country. Now, I propose to do this by having an organisation set up among the Kennedys and those other people who would like to be part of that organisation, and to first of all start with a welcome to Kennedy Country sign on the N7 motorway. The M7, you've heard about the Kennedy, the Obama Centre over in Moneygall, and set up over there. You have one American president over in Moneygall. We have another one in the vicinity of Nye and Nina in that area, which is the subject of my book on John F. Kennedy. No one has come forward to prove me wrong, so I think we can regard it as being a reasonable proposition. What I suggest is that we work at getting the stretch of the M7 named the President's Way from Obama to Kennedy, and that along the President's Way we have signs welcoming people to Kennedy Country. It's long been called the ancient country of the three O'Kennedys, Fionn Dón Rua, and to get some recognition there. For starters, if we can get something started, then we can move further down the track, 1 year, 10 years, who knows, for setting up a Kennedy Interpretive Centre. There's already one set up down at Duncanstown, which I followed the whole process through. We can look at getting a Kennedy Interpretive Centre located in the heart of Kennedy history in North Tipperary to provide a focus for the many people who wish to visit Ireland to engage in ancestry research. There are far more Kennedys outside of Ireland than there are in Ireland. There are about 6,000 in Australia. There are about 60,000 in the US. Many of them have origins in Upper Ormond, Lower Ormond, Odianara, all around North Tipperary and Kilkenny. So let's encourage them to have a place to come to. At the moment, a Kennedy coming to Tipperary, where do I go? I don't know. But if we had an interpretive centre and running tours from there, information from there, we could be sending them down to Silver Mines, sending them to Colony, sending them across to Latera, sending them to Anamina, sending them down to Killamore, and all that from there. But unless we start something, unless we have an interpretive centre, we don't have a means of directing the traffic. Now, I really would like to see something like Ballantyne Castle, right beside the motorway, being the venue for an interpretive centre. That may not be possible. If that's not possible, we could look at perhaps buying into Nina Castle, which has got plenty of room in the ground floor there, and a bunch of people there with not much knowledge of the Kennedys and what they're doing. And we've also got the Skilabeen Castle over there, which is almost completely renovated now by Kennedys, and I'm sure they'd be down there talking about it. Whichever way we went, we would have the opportunity to look at setting up a Kennedy Interpretive Centre for the purpose of recognition and commemoration of the Kennedys' 1,000-year history in Upper Ormond. The Normans have come and gone, the Cromwellians have come and gone, the penal laws have come and gone, the Kennedys are still here in numbers. And still here in their ancient territory needs to be commemorated. What I'd like to get is this group's endorsement of this proposal that we go ahead and look at setting up a Kennedy Heritage Group to further these, this proposal. If we can have a acknowledgement by raising your hands. Looks like it's unanimous. Okay, that's all I want to do. Any questions, any comments?